Hi everybody, my name is Yvonne Crotty and I'm from Dublin City University, and my colleague here, Margaret Farron, she might actually take the mic as well for later on. We'll be calling off on her. The title came about, Running a Mock, is a, I don't know if you're familiar with it, but it's a whole, it's very much a phrase that we use in Ireland when we say that the things are going mad, they're in chaos. And I suppose it really typified the fact that all universities, and especially our own, were talking about the need to have a MOOC, and that we weren't at the top of our game if we didn't have a MOOC. So our president addressed in his strategy address to the various different faculties, talked about the use of MOOCs and how we needed to be aware of MOOCs and what was going on. So myself and Margaret teach in the School of Education Studies, and we decided that what we'd do is we'd integrate using a MOOC into our classes, and the class was on the Masters in Education and Training Management e-learning. And this group of students are postgraduate students who would mainly vary, they would come from all areas and backgrounds. We would have from medical background, from teaching, all trying to learn how to improve their practice using e-learning. So what we decided we'd do was, to make it practical, there are two modules after Christmas. I teach one, it's on multimedia and how to make your own resources. And Margaret would actually look at emerging pedagogies and the whole theory behind e-learning. So what we did was, we decided that we'd, over the 12 weeks, that we would ask the students to partake in a MOOC, because we wanted them to be to learn. Well, there was lots of reasons that we wanted them to learn about MOOCs, so that they'd actually know, to have experience for themselves what it was like to partake in a MOOC, but from an auto-ethnography, to try and from a participant evaluator of that particular MOOC, and linking the theories that they were learning in the pedagogies module, and seeing, you know, were they, you know, to see, to try and connect about the connectivism, to see exactly what was actually happening in the MOOCs and whether they actually liked it or not, to their own experience. So there's, I'm going to let you just have a look at the actual assignment brief for the pedagogies. So that's, they had to look and to describe their own experience during the, it was an 8-week module in the Amsterdam, the University of Amsterdam. It was a MOOC being held, and it was an ex-MOOC. So in that MOOC, in that particular MOOC, all the students, there were a series of videos, and at the end of it, it was very much a behaviourist point, approach, in that at the end of it there were questions that they had, multiple choice questions, and as Steve said, some of them didn't even actually on purpose didn't answer the questions, but still got a commendation for having done a great job. So they was all part of the participant evaluation as they were going along. Okay, on the other side, I was linking in with my particular module, which was the whole idea of multimedia and educational innovation. And that, on that particular module, which is 12 weeks also, I would do video skills, making resources, educational resources, because I would say, well, these students, they are the best people to create their own resources. So the whole idea would be that they would use the content of what they had learned, by participating in the MOOC, by writing up their journals, and they would create then a video at the end to show what their experience was. So they were using the content of what they were learning for the video itself. And I'll have some examples of that as well. So, as I said, these were the learning outcomes of the whole lot, that they would experience, that they would know when people were talking about MOOCs, that they would actually know what it was all about. They would have a better understanding of the methodology. So it was an introduction to research and the methodology of ethnography, auto-ethnography, by using different data collection methods such as journals and such. Also video, that they would actually have evidence then by using video as well. They would also learn, they would learn about the content of the actual MOOC itself, so which was all about the science of communication. Then they could link it to the relevant literature, which was actually happening. Then we would have, in their pedagogies module, we could actually talk about it. We could go in and their experiences, we could talk about what it was, what did they feel about being part of all this, this particular MOOC. Was it a good experience? Was it similar to what they were having in their own, classes? So it was comparison, and it made for great discussions. Also, I had asked them in my particular module to create a poster. So for Margaret's module, which is the pedagogies, emergent pedagogies, they would have to write a 3,000 word essay. For mine, they would present it visually in a video and also in a poster. So the poster would be a synopsis of the actual video, so condense it. So it was using all these other skills as well, just to be able to bring it down. And then, as I said, to represent it as a video. Okay? Using online journals to be able to document their observations. Okay, and it was addressing the two ideas, the theory and practice, and comparing the MOOC and the Masters. Okay, so what do they like most? Well, when we asked, we gave them a questionnaire at the very end. So these are some of the things that they said. That the MOOC was a very enjoyable experience, but I like the fact that I was critically looking at it and reflecting on the experience while researching about MOOCs in general. It was a newish experience, opening my mind to new ideas and new methods. And I felt the MOOC forced me to consider the e-learner's perspective, and this was very valuable. It gave me a chance to see how some of the video resources are developed, and then I liked working with others in group projects, and it allowed me to show how a project can be set up and completed using Google Docs to edit and revise, and also highlighted how MOOC participation depends on people and people's personalities when motivating oneself to stick with this form of learning. Now, that particular MOOC, or that particular comment, refers to another MOOC, which is actually a C-MOOC, because one of the students did a social media, was more interested in a social media MOOC, so she asked us, could she do that one, and that's exactly, but that was 12 weeks long, but it was based on forms. It wasn't as like the X-MOOC, which was very much behaviourist in its approach. Okay, what do they least like? Well, the isolation of learning in that particular way, and they didn't always enjoy the social media MOOC at all. The volume of work was enormous. My particular MOOC was too long, and that was the person that did the social media MOOC. Two people in particular took over the group project and made all the decisions without consulting the group. I felt this undermined the group and diminished my interest in the MOOC. Now, I suppose that can happen anyway, whether it be on a MOOC or in a classroom situation, but that's one of the comments that she made. Getting the chance to see how some of the video resources are developed. I don't know, that must be... And the lack of face-to-face interaction. So the whole idea is to... I'll just go back there and I'll let you see, to double up. The whole idea is to have many focuses for this one particular exercise. So these were the actual posters that they made for me as part of their assignment. So I just, the MOOC experience, and I'm not going to actually dwell on this because I want you to see the video, two videos of the students that actually created. Okay, just let you have a look. And the whole idea with this is that the students can then see that they could create their own video, or create their own poster to present it at a conference, that they're able to do that. Okay. Okay. This is actually some of the text that I had in my abstract. And it's the whole idea that sometimes we just cannot represent in text as well as we could by video. So what I'm going to do is show you one of the videos.
Hello.
That was actually
my made name by is Stephen Howard. And welcome to my educational video called Masters versus MOOC, What is the Better Learning Experience? Before watching, I recommend you read the following learning objectives carefully to enhance your own experience. I hope you enjoy the show.
Ladies and gentlemen, and welcome. I'm standing outside Dublin City University, the venue where one of the most eagerly anticipated showdowns is about to take place. I am, of course, talking about the battle between MOOC and Masters. Three rounds will determine tonight's winner by none other than Mr. Stephen Howard, an expert and participant in both the MOOC and Masters course. As the montage has suggested, tonight we will witness one of the greatest battles in educational history. But before we do so, let's take a closer look at our competitors.
Firstly, we have the MOOC. A MOOC is a new trend of online courses and is an abbreviation for Massive Open Online Course. It's massive in the sense that it's open to a potentially much larger audience than a normal course. In fact, it's available to a worldwide audience. A MOOC is also completely open, which means it's free of cost and designed so that anyone with any specific experience can enter. Thirdly, all the lectures and class material are available through an online portal, thus explaining the online acronym. A MOOC, at its most basic level, is a course. In the case of this MOOC, the course is based on communication science. The title of this course is Introduction to Communication Science. The Communication MOOC transmits information via a
Before watching, I recommend you read the following learning objectives carefully to enhance your own experience. Hello.
A MOOC is also completely open, which means it's free of cost and designed so that anyone with any specific experience can enter. Thirdly, all the lectures and class material are available through an online portal, thus explaining the online acronym. A MOOC, at its most basic level, is a course. In the case of this MOOC, the course is based on
doesn't seem to be.
Yes. Three.
I guess what I'll do is, in the meanwhile, I'll play you this alone because it's not.
I've created this video in the hope that it will give you an idea of why I think my master's course is not suitable for a massive open online course or a MOOC. Since I began my master's course, friends and colleagues have often asked me how it's been going, and my standard answer is something like this. It's a fantastic course that has helped me apply what I have learned to my teaching practice, as well as providing me with the tools to improve teaching and learning in my school. I recently experienced what it is like to participate in a MOOC and reflected again on that question. During this reflection, I asked myself what I think separates the program at DCU from a MOOC. I quickly came up with a list of differences based on the MOOC that I had signed up to. Although this was a comprehensive overview, it would not give an outsider a true essence of what it is like to be a part of the master's course under Margaret Farren's and Yvonne Crotty's tutelage. The methodology for teaching and learning in the master's course has elements of a flipped classroom that could be well suited to a MOOC. So I decided to think about what I might be missing out on if the DCU course was offered as a MOOC. And this is what I came up with. It's very evident that caring is one of the values that both our coordinators follow. And from the outset, they both created a safe environment conducive to learning. I had insecurities about returning to college as a mature student and the difficulties that I might face, but their confidence in me as a person was inspiring. They have a good understanding of my background and how the course can be applied to my own living theory. It is this understanding that enables them to give each of their students the individual attention that is required to help us succeed in our learning. This care and attention is impossible to replicate in a MOOC course where thousands of students are enrolled. The small intimate class size helps Margaret and Yvonne employ a range of approaches to teaching and learning. These include class and online activities that incorporate group work, peer learning, reflective journaling, role play, case studies, and individual research. By actively taking part in this multimodal pedagogy, I can transfer what I have learned from this approach to my own teaching practice. I am also more comfortable learning in a small class environment where I feel that I can be confident interacting and offering my own views. In a large group, I would feel reluctant to interact and my learning would suffer as a result. A MOOC cannot offer the same variety in its approach because it is designed as an online course to service many students. For me, motivation is the key aspect to any learning, be it in a MOOC or a college course. Small class size, multimodal instruction, and individual attention, mixed with caring course coordinators, have all combined to help motivate me. Another integral motivating factor stems from the peer interaction that has played a major role in helping me explore my creative side. If the course were delivered in a MOOC, this synergy would lose its impetus. Assessment and feedback is a critical motivator, and the assessment for learning approach, based on my own context, helps. The informal feedback that I receive throughout the course has helped me immensely, whereas the automated feedback in a MOOC cannot take into account my context, and even in the most connectivist MOOC, I would receive little feedback, if any, from the lecturers. And finally, the biggest motivator of all is the award of a master's degree at the end of the DCU course. If I were taking the course as a MOOC, I would most likely have quit a long time ago.
Okay, Margaret, do you want to say anything while I try and see if I can get the other one?
We mentioned as the course is about e-learning, it's important for us to actually enable students to find out what's happening in current practice. So it's not just about learning about old practices, but how things are changing all the time and the various technologies that are being used, how they are all actually part of the MOOC. So we've got the old, and there's nothing new probably in a MOOC at all, because a lot of people are saying, a lot of researchers, that it's simply old technology sometimes being harnessed, and we've had distance learning for a long time. The Open University have been doing it very successfully. But any questions around that yet?
Thank you. So one of the many things people have said about MOOCs is that they are a great way to get research universities to talk about teaching and learning. And what interests me in the way is the way in which MOOCs have expanded the canvas on which we think about all these different processes and shone a different light.
Hello, my name is...
Competition. So I'm interested in what your students wrote about what they valued in the master's course. Did you expect what they were saying, or were there things that they were saying that you had never thought about that were perhaps implicit and tacit and sort of helped you think afresh about the value of what you did in a face-to-face way?
I think it's right. A lot of people, it's the Harvard and Stanford and the various elite universities that are actually really coming on board with the MOOCs. But what people are saying as well is that they gained the reputation on research, not on teaching and learning. So there is no guarantee that they will successfully deliver on the MOOCs. And that's what's happening a lot of times. So I think it helps universities to rethink the importance of teaching and learning, because universities are tied to the league tables, and we as lecturers are all being forced to, I suppose, in one way, link to the communities and link to the students, but at the same time, how you're valued as a lecturer is where you are actually top journals. So it's really your research and your publications as opposed to the teaching and learning. So I think the MOOCs actually start to help people to see the importance of teaching and learning. And for us, certainly, Yvonne, I know how much, Yvonne, the value of actually a safe environment in teaching, and for all of us, the importance of learning that. So I think from the students, what they felt back, I don't know, Yvonne, if you'd like to say something around.
Sorry, I actually didn't. I was concentrating on the video. Yeah. So
Well, it was just saying, did we find anything out about the feedback from the students around the MOOCs that we wouldn't have known about? Or was it a surprise what Scott said in his video?
No, but not really. I mean, some of the students, no, I have it here. Some of the students, they enjoyed the fact that they were part of a MOOC, but they think what they really enjoyed most of all was the fact that they could interact in the class sessions afterwards about what was actually happening on the MOOC and really, analyze it and dissect what it was and what they liked about it. But it was the contact, I think they really learned a lot on both sides. They analyzed it, but they also learned the content. The group... There was three actually that did the social media, and they said that the information and the content was excellent, but there was just too much. And little things that we probably would know ourselves, they would start off on a Saturday, it would start on a Saturday the next week, and they would get information, but all through the week, they were being given information. Now, I know as a teacher, and Margaret knows as a lecturer, you just can't do that with students for the simple reason that they go, hey, they get an overload. And that was one of the... Yet, if they had given it at the very beginning of the week and they had left it and intermittently just checked on the students to see how they were, it would have been far, far more effective. So, that wasn't new to us. But at the same stage, they really, enforced that was just too much. because I think that students really need to know where they're going, you know, in that way. And the whole exercise, this particular exercise, was to give them a confidence that they knew that they at least had experienced MOOCs, but there was so many other, you know, levels that they could learn on, you know, as well.
How did you, as teachers, experience the use of this MOOC at the University of Amsterdam? Will you continue using MOOCs in the future with your master's students?
Well, we've learned that we wouldn't give them the option. Let's say, for instance, the 10 weeks, for example, because you really need to, you know, you had two groups of people, students in the class. You had the three or four that were actually doing the social media, and they were stressed, but it was their choice. So we said, they asked us, you know, could they do it? So to be, you know, fair, we didn't want them doing content that they didn't particularly want to be doing themselves. So they wanted the choice. But looking at the bigger picture now, we would have been far better off for their sake to actually say, well, no, you know, listen, do the 6-week MOOC. You'll be better off because what you're trying to do is you're trying to observe and see exactly what a MOOC is like. You know, do the other MOOC in your own time at a later stage when you have the less of the restraints. So I would certainly say no, honestly, we know, and the experience has been, but now we know because the experience has been like that. So, you know, and to be tough, to be kind, really, in that way. But, you know, what we did do is say, listen, now, you know, don't have to be finishing. You only have to do 6 weeks of the social media work. Don't be worrying about the last 4 weeks because, you know, you have enough observations made over the 6 weeks. Don't be killing yourself. It's just, it's the experience of being part of being a MOOC. And we saw it. Like, there's no substitute for a caring environment that you create for learners. And sometimes, you know, as much and all as these MOOCs try to do that, they can't. They can't actually do it. I think. Are there any other questions on?
Thank you.
Oh, yeah, Sally.
No, just I'm curious to know whether in DCU, whether, because this was a little bit sparked off by the fact that your university was saying, we have to get in on this. Has there been any impact in terms of DCU's?
Well, you see, they don't know yet, because okay. I literally, that was the conversation. So I said, well, you know, let's put this to the test straight away. So that was, let's say, for instance, our classes were starting on the following week. So it was a great way of, you know, doubling up and actually seeing exactly, you know, and now we can go back and say, well, you know, whether we'll be listened to or not now is another thing. I'm
no,
sure.
But you have a good argument as far as it's a very interesting piece of research.
And that's, I mean, it makes sense that it's the intimacy of a class. Everybody wants to feel as if, I mean, there's a small group of people here and you should all be up at the front so that we can all see everybody. But, you know, it's sometimes people like to be anonymous, but I suppose the group that we have, they're coming back, they're very scared, they're very competent in their own workplaces, but yet at the same stage, no matter how competent you are and you're coming back to study, no matter what it is, you like to feel that somebody's saying, listen, are you all right there? And I suppose in a MOOC, sometimes that's not, it physically isn't possible. And I suppose, as Steve said, the whole idea of, you know, is getting an automated message and you're not even doing it, even kills it even more, because then, you know, you'd really prefer somebody say, listen, you know, you haven't done your work there, but listen, try harder next week, you know, or could you do, you know, so it's that kind of thing. So they said they missed that, but it was good because they were still getting it from the support on our side, you know. I'll just have a check and see if this is downloaded.
I have a question also.
Any more questions? Margaret, do you want to take up the...
I have a question, yes. In a while, your students will be teachers. Do you think they will use or produce MOOCs themselves? In their...
They are teachers.
They are teachers, but will they produce and use MOOCs?
I have it here now.
is a relatively new phenomena. This MOOC, designed by the University of Amsterdam, is in its very first year of running. Finally, MOOC has a whopping 5,000 enrolled participants. Next, we'll look at tonight's favourite, the Master's Programme. Master's programmes have been around for many years and are plentiful throughout all third level institutes. They, like MOOCs, are offered through a wide range of subjects. However, unlike the MOOC, they are usually not free of charge with expensive yearly fees. Therefore, master's programmes can exclude potential learners who cannot afford to participate. The title of the master's in question is the Master's in Education and Training Management, e-learning strand. This master's undertakes a blended approach to learning as behaviourist, constructivist, socialist and humanist theories align with technology during the course. The learning approaches incorporated are also learner-centred. The Master's in Education and Training Management has a duration of 2 years, though it has been established in DCU for over 10 years now. The current first-year class has approximately 20 participants, all coming from different backgrounds and working sectors.
So there you have it. Two very different competitors, both striving towards the same goal, to educate. Tonight's fight will determine the better learning experience under three headings: participation, lifelong learning, and accreditation. We are now ready to go live inside the walls of DCU. But before we do so, ask yourself, what do you think will be the better learning experience? MOOC or Masters?
Let's get ready to rumble!
In round one, we'll focus on the idea of participation in a course. The MOOC, due to its online nature and lack of fees, attracts a huge crowd. This MOOC on communication science enrolls over 5,000 participants, though some might rightfully question how many of the enrolled participants are actively engaging. On the other hand, the master's course can only accept 20 or so participants due to a combination of funding, location, and classroom size. Encouragingly, the 20 participants actively engage through weekly interaction. However, if only 2% of the participants in the communication MOOC actively engage, this course will still have 100 actively engaging participants. As a result, on a very close call, the winner of round one goes to the MOOC. In round two, we will focus on the idea of lifelong learning. Because it is difficult to assess such a large number of participants in such a short space of time, the MOOC can be limited in regard to teaching and learning. The MOOC in Communication Science applied a multiple choice method to assessment. The behaviourist, transmission-based approach applied throughout encourages short-term learning. On the other hand, the e-learning-based masters promotes a blended, multi-learning approach. The entire focus and direction is learner-centred. The development and evolution of a community practice is also apparent. This evidence combined displays that lifelong learning is a desired outcome in this course. As a result, on another very close call, the winner of this round goes to the Masters. This final decisive round will focus on the idea of accreditation. The Masters provide successful participants with a highly recognised qualification. How, you might ask? Well, the masters can provide concrete evidence of student learning and progression. This places the masters in a very strong position. The MOOC in communication science, like many of its counterparts, is severely lacking in recognition. This is due to an understandable concern over quality and consistency in pedagogy and assessment. This is the MOOC's current Achilles heel and will need to be addressed in the future. So, as a result, this final round must go to none other than the Masters.
And the winner, by unanimous decision, the Masters in Education and Training Management, E-Learning Strand!
So there you have it, folks. It's official. The Masters is still the champion, the better learning experience. Some might say the result was a little predictable. Nevertheless, it was not only enjoyable, but more importantly, educational. That's all from DCU. A good day to you.
Okay. Any questions? Just to let you know, that was the first time. Stephen hadn't actually used cameras or anything like that. His first use of cameras was actually on that particular module. He said it himself that he hadn't used video before. So, and that's the whole idea, that students would have the content, and I suppose in many ways it makes them, it focuses their attention. Any questions, any more questions before we finish up? Yes. No questions, Peter?
We are from the University of Amsterdam, and yes. We were wondering if you had contact with the professor of this.
Yes, book. He did.
Yeah?
He did.
And what was, did you discuss your evaluation?
Yeah, the actual, Stephen was in touch. He was actually in touch with the professor, just to ask him could he have permission to use the actual, the shots, screenshots.
And did they discuss their outcome, the outcomes of your, or the evaluations of your students? Did they discuss the thoughts about MOOC and Master?
No.
Not at all.
No.
Would you like to have a kind of?
Yeah, no. It would actually be a very good follow-up session. Yeah, it would. It would be excellent for those students to actually, you know, talk. I mean, you'll see that they did see that it was actually, that they said it was very good, and there was an awful lot of information. That wasn't the problem. They were just comparing which would they prefer. That was it. But the content, they said that the content.
Yeah, understand, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And that is very important. The actual content was, they had no problem with content.
No, yeah, I was just wondering, because at the University of Amsterdam, we're thinking also, would we like to continue, and which way, and...
Yes, yeah. So it would be good evidence to yes.
Okay, thanks.
Yes.
Any other questions?
No. Okay. We're all set. The fight is over. Okay.